from Bailey Hall, where we are prepared to have the two major party candidates for Florida governor square off for the next hour. Good evening, everyone. I'm Elliot Rodriguez, anchor at WFOR-CBS Miami. Joining us on the panel tonight are Rosemary Goodrow, the editorial page editor of the South Florida Sun-Sentinel, and Frank Denton. Frank is the editor of the Florida Times Union newspaper in Jacksonville. We would like to thank and welcome all of you who are watching us, and we'd like to thank our host tonight, Broward College and its president, J. David Armstrong Jr., who is joining us here in the audience along with a group of students. Tonight's debate is set to be interactive. We want to hear from you. We have a panel of journalists who will be monitoring all of your questions and comments on Facebook and Twitter at hashtag FLGovDebate. On the panel are Manny Garcia. Manny is the executive editor of the Naples Daily News, and Patricia Mazzei. Patricia is a reporter for the Miami Herald. Also joining us is Bob Gabordi, the executive editor of the Tallahassee Democrat, and Jeremy Wallace, the political editor of the Sarasota Herald Tribune. And right now, we want to take a shot of the stage here at Bailey Hall in Broward County. And as you can see, the two candidates who were invited to take part in this debate right now are not stepping up on the stage. Ladies and gentlemen, we have an extremely peculiar situation right now. We have Governor Charlie Crist. Florida Governor Rick Scott, our incumbent governor and the Republican candidate for governor, is also in the building. Governor Rick Scott, we have been told that Governor Scott will not be participating in this debate. Now, let me explain what this is all about. Governor Crist has asked to have a fan, a small fan, placed underneath his podium. The rules of the debate that I was shown by the Scott campaign say that there should be no fan. Somehow there is a fan there, and for that reason, ladies and gentlemen, I am being told that Governor Scott will not join us for this debate. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a debate. Rosemary Goodrow, I don't know, what can we say?
Well,
that's the ultimate pleading of the fifth I've ever heard in my life. Wow. Yeah, it is.
No, I'm not.
I'm sad the people of Florida aren't going to get to hear about
it. We're not asking you a question. We're not asking a question of Governor Crist.
So
I'm asking Rosemary about the situation that we have find ourselves in.
Governor Crist, do the rules of the debate say that there should be no fan?
Not that I'm aware of.
So the rules that the Scott campaign just showed us that says that no electronics can be used,
including fans? Are we really
going to
debate about a fan, or are we going to talk about education and the environment and the future of our state? I mean, really. There are serious issues facing our state, and it's like funding education appropriately, Frank, protecting our environment, making sure we have ethical, honest leadership.
Governor.
I mean, if he's going to give it to me, I'm going to take it.
This is not a platform for one candidate. We're hoping that Governor Scott will join us on the stage.
Well,
and I
great.
Am told that Governor Scott will join us on the stage. In all fairness to Governor Scott, I was shown a copy of the rules that they showed me that said there would be no fans on the podium. And
they're my fans.
So.
Very strange.
to get rid of the ban?
My understanding is that Governor Scott will be coming out.
Not in my life. Unimaginable.
Frank, have you ever seen anything like this?
No, I haven't. This is remarkable over sort of a trivial issue, no matter which side you believe you're on.
We were placed in the awkward situation of having to decide this, and I don't think it's our role to determine. Governor, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that has to be the most unique beginning to any debate.
I don't think we'll forget.
Not only in Florida, but I think anywhere in the country. Let's start with, first of all, the rules. The rules of this debate are 1 minute for the question to the first candidate. The second candidate will have a minute, and then the first candidate will have 30 seconds to respond. We want to get a lightning round in here with 20 seconds. Let's get right to it, and let's ask the first question, which was determined by a coin toss, to Governor Crist. Governor Crist, you have spent millions of dollars in this campaign defining your opponent through negative advertising, and in the end, the voters are unhappy with their choices. Based on social media posts we have monitored, the public is frustrated by the tone and rancor of this campaign. Tonight, without attacking your opponent, define yourself for the voters and tell them why you deserve to be governor.
Thank you very much. First, I want to thank you for sponsoring this debate. And Governor, it's good to have you with us now. I want to start out by saying that I grew up in Florida. I love this state. I've been here for 55 years, growing up in St. Petersburg, and I care deeply about public education. I'm a public school kid myself, graduating from St. Pete High in 1974. I think it's important that we reinvest in education because we need to. I also think that it's important that we do what's right for higher education. I'm a graduate of Florida State University, and I know that our higher education institutions, our great universities, need to have appropriate investment. And finally, I know that it's important for the future of Florida that we get focused on the middle class and job creation, creating jobs that pay well, not just minimum wage, although I think we need to raise the minimum wage, but we need to give an opportunity for people in the middle class to do better for themselves and their children. And it all starts with a great education.
Thank you, Governor Crist. Governor Scott, same question to you.
Sure. First, I want to thank everybody at Leadership Florida for the opportunity to be here. I want to thank my wife, who's been with me since I was 19. We've been married 42 years, and we are blessed with two wonderful daughters, three grandsons, who hopefully are, my almost three-year-old is able to see tonight. He got poked in the eye today at school. But why should they elect me as governor again? I grew up in a family that struggled. You saw the ads in 2010. It's embarrassing my mom called me a good boy, but she was a wonderful mom. She was willing to divorce a husband that was abusive, which gave me a shot. If she had not abused that, divorced that man, I don't know what my life would have been like. She remarried, five kids. They struggled to put food on the table. We lived in public housing, but she told me, Rick, if you'll go to church a lot, if you'll study hard, make straight A's, if you'll be an Eagle Scout, then you have a shot at the American dream. I ran in 2010 because I believe in the dream.
Thank you, Governor
I've led that dream.
Governor Crist, your rebuttal?
Yeah, well, you know, I think it's important that we reinvest in education. We talked about that earlier. And unfortunately, Rick Scott cut education by $1.3 billion. You can't do that. You can't cut education to the bone that way and expect our children to get a good, solid education and have an opportunity going forward to have a good employment and a great career. So I think we have to focus on that. We have to have a laser focus on it, in my view. And we also have to focus on our universities, as I stated before. Again, unfortunately, Rick Scott took $300 million away from our universities his second year.
The next question from Rosemary Gaudreau to Governor Scott.
Governor Scott, you claim Florida lost 825,000 jobs because of Charlie Crist. Can you tell us what Governor Crist specifically did to cause those job losses?
Sure. Actually, it was 832,000 jobs. They were lost between 2006, when Charlie got elected, and Jeb Bush left him with a great economy. And by the time he left office, unemployment went from 3.5 to 11.1%. the second highest increase in unemployment in the country. Here's what he didn't do, and here's what he did. Step one, he raised taxes. He raised taxes on our citizens by $2.2 billion. $2.2 billion. You should never raise taxes, especially after he said he wouldn't, but in a recession where people can't afford it. He said, if you have a child that's going to go to university, he said, it's going to cost you more money. He wasn't willing to call on companies. I talk to companies all the time. Charlie wouldn't call on them. He wouldn't help economic development efforts. He raised regulation. If you think about building a business, I want to build those businesses to be in Florida. Lower taxes, less regulation, streamline the permitting process. That's why we lost 832,000 jobs while Charlie was governor.
Governor Crist?
The people of Florida know that I didn't cause the global economic meltdown any more than, thank you, any more than Rick Scott caused the national economic recovery. People are smarter than that. They understand and they understood that we were serving in a difficult time, and we had to make tough choices, and it wasn't easy, but we got Florida through. One of the ways we got Florida through was to work in a bipartisan way, to work with people across the aisle, to take the recovery money and help us make sure we didn't have to fire 20,000 school teachers. That is something that Rick Scott said was an absolute mistake. What would he do if we have a double dip and something goes wrong with the economy again? Thank because you. Of politics, not seek help?
Charlie's campaign slogan should be, Charlie Crist, powerless for the jobless. What you just heard is he couldn't do anything. He wanted the job as a governor, but he didn't want to call on companies. He didn't want to do the tough things. He didn't want to cut regulation. He didn't want to do the job. He spent all of his time trying to be vice president and then run against Marco Rubio for the Senate. He lost 3,000 teachers lost their job while Charlie was governor. 832,000 people lost their job.
Thank you, Governor Scott. Frank?
Governor Crist, you support, as you said, you support raising the minimum wage, and I think you've said you'd raise it to $10.10.
Yes.
The other side of that is that points out that there are many small businesses that are struggling to keep the doors open, keep operating. Why should government tell them what they should pay their employees?
I think it's important to raise the minimum wage because it's very hard for people to get by on what the minimum wage is today in Florida. $7.93 is not enough to make ends meet. Raising it to $10.10 would be a 27% increase in income for hundreds of thousands of Floridians. What a difference that would make in the economy. More money they would have in their pocket to be able to go to mom and pop small businesses around the state, have the opportunity to in turn help those businesses do better and pay their employees more. You know, things aren't great in Florida right now. I've recently been on a kitchen table tour talking to real people, and they are challenged. Some of them have to work two and three jobs to make ends meet. That's not right. Florida can do better than that, and we deserve better than that. You deserve to have a governor who will fight for you, fight for raising the minimum wage, fight for equal pay for women. Rick Scott is against both. It's unfortunate, but we can fix it, and I look forward to it.
Governor Scott.
So Charlie is a lot of talk, but Charlie's not a lot of action. He had the opportunity. He voted against minimum wage when he was in the Senate. He didn't think it was the right thing to do, so he voted against it. But you know, here's the problem. I want jobs. Charlie lost 832,000 jobs, and he wants to lose more. The CBO says 500,000 jobs will be lost if Charlie gets his minimum wage increase. I don't want any of those individuals to lose a job. I know what it's like. I had parents that didn't have a job. I had parents that watched their home almost be repossessed, their car being taken. Charlie doesn't worry about those people. He doesn't know what it's like to be like that. Charlie is the zero-wage governor. 832,000 people went from wages to zero wages when Charlie was governor.
Governor Crist, you have a rebuttal.
Rick, there you go again, trying to blame the global economic meltdown on me. It is unbelievable that he would continue to say that, but he says it. And he also says that he created all these new jobs all by himself. You just can't trust Rick, and it's sad, it's unfortunate. You know, he has spent so much money on television advertisements. The media themselves have said they're the most negative ads that have ever been aired in Florida and the most dishonest. and he's continuing that dishonesty today. When he tells you that I lost a bunch of jobs or he brought them back, it's just not true.
Your time's up for the rebuttal. Right now, we want to hear from the voters. This debate is connected through social media, through our social media panel. So let's find out what the voters are saying through social media. Let's go to Manny Garcia of the Naples Daily News. And Manny, what's trending on social media right now? And we need you to ask a question of Governor Scott.
Well, the fan, but no, actually, one of the things that's trending is, Elliot, you started it off, but really, I don't think the candidates answered it. So for Governor Scott, one of the things that continuously comes up is that between you and special interest groups, and I think it also applies to Governor Crist, but tens of millions of dollars has been spent, what really amounts to a scorched earth campaign between you two. So one of the question is, why should you be reelected when the campaign is so dirty?
When I talk to voters, they tell me they care about three things. And it's very similar to my family growing up. Step one, they want a job. They want a job, they want a job, they want a job. They want a governor that says, I'm going to get up every day, I'm not going to be running for vice president, I'm not going to be running for the U.S. Senator, I'm going to get up every day and say, how can I get more jobs? How can I get a company like Hertz to move their corporate office? How can I get Lockheed Martin to move more jobs here? How can I get Northrop Grumman to move more jobs here? Who's going to travel to make sure that I get more jobs? Number two, it's like my mom. She said, Rick, get a good education. Education funding was cut when Charlie was governor. When he left, both per student and overall K-12 education was less than it was when he started. So, and third, they want to live in a safe environment. So what I work at every day, jobs, better education system, make sure you can live in a safe neighborhood.
Governor Crist, you want to address the nastiness of this campaign and the ads, the negative ads? People are just turned off by them.
Yeah, well, of course they are. So am I. I've had about $50 million of negative ads thrown on me. You think I'm not tired of it? I think it's important that we be able to talk about Florida's future. This is a race about the future of our state. You have to make a decision in less than 3 weeks about who you want to be your next governor. Rick Scott has talked about the fact that he's called companies around the country to try to bring them to our state. That's true. And he's also offered them about $266 million to come here. And they've only come through with 4% of the jobs that they promised. That's a 96% failure on jobs in that program. Now, what would I do with that $266 million? What I think is the right thing for you, what I think is the right thing for Florida. I would invest that money in Florida small businesses, make sure that they have a fighting chance. I think we need to protect Florida first instead of bringing companies from outside the state that cannibalize our own businesses. It's important to be focused on the Sunshine State, doing what's right for our people, and make sure that they have a fighting chance and a fair shot and somebody who will fight for you.
Governor Scott, do you have a rebuttal?
Sure. I mean, this is all talk versus action. Charlie had the job. He didn't want to do the job. He didn't want to call on the companies. And what's interesting is, why wouldn't he want Hertz to move a corporate office here? Why wouldn't he want Northrop Grumman to add jobs, pay $85,000? Hertz, 700 jobs, average income $102,000. We have 261,000 job openings in the state right now, average income for the top 25 in demand, $27 an hour. And that's not what Charlie wants?
Thank you, Governor. The next question will be to Governor Crist. Governor Crist, we're on a college campus right now, and we have college students here who worry about tuition and debt. You signed a bill allowing universities to raise tuition 15% a year. Governor Scott has prohibited further increases and has pushed state colleges to offer four-year degrees for $10,000. What do you say to kids now burdened with so much college loan debt?
Well, let's look at all the facts, Elliot. What Governor Scott did, in addition to what you said, the first year he allowed tuition to go up 15%. So the premise of the question isn't correct. Number two, I think it's also important to point out to college students that if you had the hope of going to college on a Bright Future scholarship, 50,000 of you are not able to do so today because of Rick Scott. Now, I don't know why they reduced him that much. I only know that those are what the facts are, and facts are stubborn things. So if you want to have the opportunity to go to college and to do so in a way that you can afford it, I would seek your vote, because I'll restore those cuts to Bright Future scholarships because you need them and you deserve them. There's a young lady here tonight named Marcella. I went to her house in Miami just over a week ago and sat down with her, and she was upset because she couldn't get a Bright Future scholarship, and she had a 4.7 grade point average. That's unbelievable to me, but it's because of the cuts that Rick Scott has brought to education.
Thank you, Governor. Governor Scott.
So Charlie is not concerned about the facts. He'll say anything. If you want to get the facts, go to factsforflorida.com. Factsforflorida.com. You can follow the truth. So first off, Bright Futures. The legislature, both under Charlie and me, raised eligibility. But because of Charlie's 15% plus inflation, tuition increases every year, when you think you get a free ride through Bright Futures, you don't anymore because of Charlie's increase. Charlie, when you think about a prepay, think about a brand new parent. Think, I'm going to save my money, make sure my child can go to university. It was $102 when Charlie started. When he left, it was $253. We today have the highest funding for K-12, highest funding for state colleges, highest funding for universities in the history of the state. And we stopped Charlie's tuition increase. So now 18,000 families this month got back $200 million. $200 million back in their pockets.
Governor, Chris, your rebuttal?
Sorry.
Your rebuttal?
Yes. You know, Rick talks about telling the truth. That's an interesting thing to assert from a guy who ran a company who had to pay the largest fine for fraud in the history of the United States of America. The truth hurts sometimes. And Rick, this is also a fact. You pled the fifth 75 times so you wouldn't have to answer to questions involved in it. That is not the kind of leadership that Florida deserves.
Thank you, Governor Chris. Audience, please hold your applause so we can get as many questions as possible. The next one from Rosemary to Governor Scott.
Governor Scott, environmentalists are unhappy that you cut the budget for water management boards, eliminated the department that regulated big new housing developments, and in a record high budget year gave only $17 million to the public land buying program, Florida Forever. A budget says a lot about a leader's priorities. Where does the environment rank in yours?
Sure. So here's what we've accomplished so far. When I took office, it was a big surprise to me that Charlie had sat on his hands while we had a decades-old lawsuit over the Everglades. So I went about, I sat down with the Department of Justice, Interior, EPA, Corps of Engineers to try to settle that lawsuit. I got the environmentalists on board, I got the ag community on board, and we had a record settlement. I went back to the legislature and they invested $880 million to restore the Everglades, something Charlie didn't lift a finger to do. On top of that, we put $100 million to protect our coral reefs, something Charlie didn't put a dime into. We had record funding for our springs, something Charlie wasn't willing to do. What Charlie was willing to do on the Everglades is go buy land that we couldn't use to restore the Everglades, stop projects that would have helped us. But, and then on top of that, even on Florida Forever, as we turned our budget around, we started investing. What did Charlie do? Spent less money every year.
Thank you, Governor Scott. Governor Chris?
Thank you. Florida's a special place. And you need to have somebody who really cares about the state to protect our environment and our Everglades. You know, Marjorie Stoneman Douglas wrote a wonderful book called The River of Grass. In that book, she put forward the thought that if you want to protect the Everglades, you have to buy it. Well, we started doing that during my first term as your governor, and we got a lot of it done. We were able to get about 26,000 acres that we could now make pristine and hold and preserve and restore the natural flow of water south. What happened after Rick Scott got in? What happened is that he started the discharges that were coming out of Lake Okeechobee and polluting the Caloosahatchee River near Fort Myers and Cape Coral, as well as the St. Lucie River on the east coast of Florida. In fact, when he went to the east coast to look at it on the Treasure Coast and what was happening in the Indian River Lagoon, he wouldn't even get out and talk to the people. They were so upset. 500 of them showed up. He wouldn't show up to talk to them or answer their questions. It's a pattern.
It's Chris.
Go to factsforflorida.com and you get the truth. So Charlie stopped after the state had spent $272 million $270 million of your tax money was spent on Reservoir A1, Charlie stopped it. If we had finished that reservoir, none of the water would have had to be discharged out of Lake Okeechobee. So if Charlie would have done the right things, maybe he would have spent some time trying to restore the Everglades, but he did nothing on the environment.
Governor Crist, Florida has refused to accept $51 billion over 10 years to expand Medicaid. Hospitals want it, doctors want it, a lot of other people are asking for it. Some states have found a way to accept it. Florida has not. Governor Scott said he was against it, and then he was for it, but he didn't push for it with the legislature. Should we accept the Medicaid money, and if so, under what arrangement? Would we just take it, or would we have a unique way of doing it the way some other states have done?
This is such an important issue, Frank. I'm glad you asked about it. Medicaid expansion means an awful lot to about 1 million of our fellow Floridians who are currently not getting the health care that they deserve and, more importantly, that they need. They're not getting it because, sadly, Rick Scott won't lift a finger to get it done, and I don't know why. What I do know is that they deserve to have those funds. We deserve to have a governor who will enact making sure that we get that Medicaid expansion money. It's money you've already sent to Washington, and you simply deserve to get back. People are hurting and they are suffering. In addition to the $51 billion it would bring to the state over the next 10 years, some studies indicate it would create about 120,000 jobs. That's the right thing to do. Talk about, you know, all talk and no action. He said he supported it. We don't have it. No action.
Governor Scott.
Let's go back to the facts here. Charlie was governor. He was sitting in the governor's office. There was a legislative session going on when Obamacare passed. Did he go to the legislature and say, oh, let's pass this because it's such a great idea? No. He called a special session that day. Did he say, this is what we, I want to get Medicare expansion or Medicaid expansion done? No. Obamacare is a bad law. People are losing their doctors. They're losing their plans. What I said is, as long as the federal government wants to pay 100%, I would not stand in the way. But I'm not willing to do what Charlie did and bankrupt our state.
Governor Crist, you have a rebuttal.
Well, he's been governor 4 years. I would think that you would understand you don't bankrupt the state. You have to balance the budget. It's in the Constitution. We did it every year of my 4 years as your governor.
Thank you, Governor Scott. Thank you, Governor Crist. This concludes the first half of our debate. And remember, our debate is interactive. Our social media panel continues to track your reactions and comments. The candidates will answer your questions when we come back after a 2-minute break.
During the debate, we heard a question about the campaign ads running in Florida. Here on C-SPAN, we're going to show you a couple of the ads during the break.
As governor, Charlie Crist cost Florida over 800,000 jobs. On the other hand, Rick Scott has created hundreds of thousands of jobs, and it is predicted that he will create 1 million by 2018. A vote for Rick Scott is a vote for more employed Floridians and a prospering free market economy. Rick Scott, for jobs, for Florida, for governor.
Rick Scott is blaming me for the financial crisis? That's ridiculous. Here's the truth. The recession wasn't caused by me or by you. You know who caused it? Greedy Wall Street bankers and corporate takeover artists. In other words, guys like Rick Scott. His company committed outright fraud. So when you see his ads, remember it was guys like Rick Scott that crashed our economy. I'm Charlie Crist. I work for you, the people. Always have and always will.
This isn't just a doorway to a school. It was my doorway as a public school kid to opportunity. And I want to make sure every child has that same chance for a better life. But Rick Scott's education cuts are closing that door on Florida's kids, spending almost $200 less per student than when I was governor, and cutting Bright Future scholarships in half. When I was governor, we brought both parties together to open the doors of opportunity, not close them. And together, we can do it again.
Sponsored by Let's Get to Work. Just the other day.
Do you think that nothing about Obamacare has irreparably harmed Floridians in any way?
No, I don't think so at all. I think it's been great.
Great? News reports say 300,000 health plans canceled. Obama says patients may lose their doctors. The federal government says less work hours for American jobs.
I think it's been great.
Great, Charlie? Obamacare may be great for Charlie's political career, but it's not great for the rest of us.
And now back to the debate for Florida's governor.
Welcome back to our debate at Bailey Hall in Broward College in Davie. We want to ask the audience here at Bailey Hall to please hold their applause so we can get as many questions in as possible. Right now, I want to toss it over to my colleague at CBS4, anchor Erica Sargent, who is with our social media panel. Erica.
Elliot, thank you. I am Erica Sargent, and hundreds of you are interacting with us on Facebook and Twitter using the hashtag FLGovDebate. And right now, the three top trending topics on social media are 1, economy and jobs, 2, the cost of higher education, and the third trending topic is climate change and its impact on Florida. So now we want to turn back to our social media panel, and I'm going to turn it over to Patricia Mazzei with the Miami Herald. So Patricia, with all that we're seeing on Facebook and Twitter, what is the question that you now have for Governor Crist?
Governor Crist, it seems like a lot of viewers want to know how it is that you think, how you can solve problems, both you and Governor Scott. So my question is, when science is at odds with religion, when you're faced with a question where science is not consistent with your faith, how do you deal with that problem? If somebody asks you, is the Earth 4.5 billion years old or 6,000 years old, what do you say?
Well, my religion's very important to me. I have a very deep faith in God. And every morning I read the Bible. It's important to keep centered and keep focused on that. And so I take it very seriously, and I also try to utilize science and learn as much as I can. On the issue of climate change, it's pretty clear to me that man is contributing to this problem. We're in South Florida tonight, and it seems to me that in South Florida, as well as the rest of the state, we're really ground zero for this issue. Now, my opponent doesn't believe in it or says he's not a scientist or whatever. But I believe it's happening. And I think we have an obligation to try to stop it. It's why I held climate change summits in the past and signed executive orders to reduce emissions to address it. I mean, if you're on Miami Beach tonight and you go to Alton Road, you'll find that many days it is actually flooding when it's not raining. That tells you all you need to know.
Thank
we
you,
need
Governor
to address
Crist.
It.
Governor Scott.
Well, I grew up in the Methodist Church. My mom made sure I went to church a lot. My mom and my grandmother were devout Christians. Jesus Christ became my Savior at a very young age. I read the Bible. I like to listen to sermons. My faith is very important to me, and I know it's very important to my family, to my wife. Now, when I think about problems, I think about solutions. So let's take global warming. What we've done since I got elected is focus on the solution. We've spent $350 million to deal with sea level rise. We spent $100 million to deal with protecting our coral reefs. We've increased the funding by 45% for beach renourishment. On top of all the other things, our springs, trying to move water south, the $880 million we put into the Everglades. But my faith is very important to me. I believe in it. But I'm also going to try to solve any problems I see need to be solved.
Governor Crist, your rebuttal?
Sure. I really don't have a rebuttal to that. I mean, you know, we all have the right to feel how we feel about our Creator. And I respect that different people may have a different point of view. For me, I happen to be a Methodist, too. Maybe it's the only thing we agree on tonight, Rick. But, you know, faith is very important. Science is important, too. My father happens to be a medical doctor, and so is one of my three sisters a medical doctor. So I think the combination of science is important, and the core beliefs of your religion are more significant than anything.
Thank you, Governor Crist. Rosemary?
Governor Scott, you say you're against discrimination, but the courts have said Florida's ban on same-sex marriage is unconstitutional because it is discriminatory. Do you think the ban is discriminatory?
Well, let's think about where we are. None of us believe in discrimination. I clearly don't believe in any discrimination. In 2008, part of our democratic process, led by Charlie, there was a constitutional amendment passed that said marriage would be between a man and a woman. While I believe in traditional marriage, we've got to understand people have different views. It's going through the court system. My understanding is it's going to the Supreme, right directly to the Supreme Court. Whatever the Supreme Court decides, they'll decide what the law in Florida is. I will abide by that law. But what's important to me is we need to understand people have different views. We need shouldn't have ill will because people have different views. But we have to remember all this was started with Charlie as governor.
Governor Scott, I'm not sure I got an answer to the question.
Sure.
I'm not sure I got an answer to the question. Do you believe the ban is discriminatory?
I don't believe in discrimination, I can tell you, I don't believe in discrimination. I believe in traditional marriage. The court's going to decide. This is a decision for the courts, and they'll ultimately make the decision.
Governor Crist?
I don't believe in discrimination either. And I don't believe in it so much that I believe that gay couples should have the right to marry. I think the best way to capture this, Rosemary, you tried to get an answer, it's difficult, but I think the best way to capture this is to understand that who is it for us to tell other people who to love? And what is it in our right to tell other people who to marry? I think we've come to a place in American society, and certain, I think Florida is leading the way with the decisions that have been made. This is the right thing to do. We need to move forward.
Thank you, Governor Crist. So,
Charlie just told you his beliefs today, but you have to remember when he gave an interview about this issue before, he said he took his prior positions for political expediency, meaning as a way to win office. We don't actually know what Charlie believes on this issue because he's taken every side of this position, every side of this issue.
Okay, thank you. Our next question is from Frank Denton.
Governor Crist, education research shows that of all the factors that affect a child's academic success, two-thirds of them are outside the school, mostly in the family and in the community. Especially in poor communities, success in school can be undercut by poor parenting or some other part of unhealthy home life. Should the state have a role in this crucial part of educating our children? And if so, what should it be?
The state definitely should. The state always has. I mean, when I went to high school, I played high school football. It was an after-school program, if you will. You know, we had band, we had music, arts, sports. And one of the things that really saddened me when Governor Scott cut education funding by $1.3 billion his first year is that some entire schools had to be shut down. You know, after-school programs across the state had to be mothballed. In my home county of Pinellas, AP classes had to grow their class size by almost 30%. That is not the right thing to do to help a community, to help a school, or to help a child. And so I think we have to do, as I said at the outset, reinvest in education because of the dramatic cuts that Rick Scott has brought about. Those are the facts. They're stubborn things, but we need to move forward.
Governor Crist, that's investing in the schools. The question was about, does the state have a responsibility with family life, teaching people how to be better parents, preparing kids to go to school so that they can perform?
Well, I think the best way to do that is to try to lead by example. Any of us do that in our communities. You know, whether you're working with the Boy Scouts or you're working with whatever the organization might be, I think it's important that all of us play a role in that, whether it's the state or the private
sector. Thank you, Governor Crist. Governor Scott?
Well, first off, I believe in parental rights. I was blessed that I have a mom that was willing to go through a painful divorce while she was pregnant with me because she was married to an abusive man. But I believe that unless you know, we see problems, we need to give parents the opportunity to raise their children. Everybody has different goals for their children. They don't exactly do exactly what we think. Ann and I had goals for our daughters, and I know our daughters have goals, and their husbands have goals for our grandchildren. I think we need to leave as much parenting as we can to parents. And at school, our job is to educate them to, so they're going to be solid citizens and they can have great careers. But I believe in parental rights.
All right, gentlemen, can we move on to the next question? Governor Scott, the next question is to you. Watching everything that evolved around the shooting death of Trayvon Martin and the trial of George Zimmerman, do you think justice was served in that case?
Well, I'll tell you, here's what I did. And I first sat down with Trayvon's parents, Sabrina and Tracy. I wanted to make sure they felt comfortable that law enforcement was going to do a proper investigation. Then I sat down with them to when I brought in the special prosecutor, Angela Corey, to try to make sure they were comfortable that justice would be served. It went through the system. I respect the system we have in our state. I want to really thank Trayvon Martin's parents because some of the issues that they've had in Missouri we didn't have here, and a lot of it was because of his parents. I mean, my heart goes out to them. I can't imagine losing a child, a grandchild. But I want to thank Trayvon's parents, Sabrina and Tracy, because they did a great job making sure we didn't have the problems that we had in Missouri.
Governor Crist, was justice served in that case?
It's hard to say. Neither of us were on the jury. So we don't know the facts as well as the jury in that case know the facts. I used to be the attorney general, and I understand that judging from afar is not a very good idea. What I do know, though, is this stand your ground law needs to be fixed. It's a problem. I know that we have the right to defend ourselves. I think everybody believes in that American premise, and it's the right thing to do to be able to defend yourself and your property. But when it gets to the point, and you've got a statute on the books that allows the initiator of an instigation to end up killing another human being after they started the incident, there is something fundamentally flawed with that law. I believe that we can protect the right to defend yourself and make sure that we don't have laws on the books that end up with the tragic death of Trayvon Martin.
Let me just follow up. Governor, would you change the Stand Your Ground law?
No, I would not change the law. I think that death is a tragic death, but I believe in the right to defend yourself. I can't imagine losing a child like that. But I've talked to sheriffs and police chiefs. 40 sheriffs have endorsed me. Police Chiefs Association has, and I stand with them that we need to have the existing law in place.
Thank you, Governor. Rosemary.
Governor Crist, Florida is the Sunshine State, yet we're not in the top 10 for solar power development. Georgia installed more solar power last year than Florida's installed in the past 3 years. Why isn't Florida aspiring to be a leader in solar energy?
Florida should be. We should be the global leader in solar energy development. My goodness, we're the Sunshine State. It doesn't make any sense not to do so. So you have to ask, why aren't we doing that? We started doing that during my administration between 2007 and 2011. Unfortunately, with Rick Scott's administration, they are the friends of the utility industry. They are funding his very campaign. And they have laws on the books that make it incredibly difficult for companies that want to develop solar energy in Florida, in the Sunshine State, to be able to do so. So, well, how do you fix it? You elect a different governor who believes in solar energy, believes in wind, believes in renewables, believes in these cleaner energy sources, is not, you know, beholden to the utility companies that keep jacking up your bills like Duke and FP&L. It's just wrong. You need to have a governor who's on your side, who has a bright idea, no pun intended, about solar energy in the Sunshine State, because it's simply the right thing to do.
Governor Scott.
Well, first off, Charlie doesn't worry about the facts. While he was governor, utility costs went up 30%. They went below the national average to above the national average. Since I got elected, utility rates have come down 11%. Now we're below the national average. Now, with regard to solar, we need to have an attitude that we want everything, but it's got to be reliable and it's got to be cost effective. If Charlie had his way, we'd go the path of California. What's the path of California? It's a 40% increase in electricity for our residents. If the average person in our state pays right now about $208 in electricity a month, that would be an $80 increase. So Charlie can talk all these things he'd like to do, but it's going to come out of your pocket. a 40% increase because he wants to do, and remember, when he was there, a 30% increase in utility cost.
Let's get back to the truth. The increase in your utility bills has happened under the last 4 years. You at home watching tonight know if your bills are going up under Rick Scott. I know mine is, and I'm sure yours probably is too. You also know that your property insurance bills are going up under Rick Scott. You may not know this. He actually signed into law recently a law that says that the Office of Insurance Regulation cannot regulate insurance. Does that make sense to anybody? What does to the insurance companies?
Can I respond to that?
Yes.
It's not true.
Oh, it's true.
So here's the facts. Charlie's Obamacare law has the federal government, HHS, deciding all the rates for those plans. Why would the state do the exact same thing? They wouldn't do the same thing. They have no power to do the same thing. HHS is deciding all those rates. And Charlie signed legislation that allowed companies like Duke to pass on costs for power plants that were never built.
That's not true.
I stopped.
That was Jeb Bush.
You can go to Facts for Florida. You can go to Facts for Florida, and they'll explain, and they'll show you the bill that Charlie signed.
Denton has the next question for Governor Scott.
Governor Scott, Florida is seeing a revolt over high-stakes testing in our schools. The federal government's played something of a role, but Florida lawmakers have added even more tests and tied them to teacher pay. Are all these tests needed to preparing our kids for the future?
Sure. You know, I think what we all believe in is we all want to make sure children get a great education, and we all know that measurement works. It does work. But people are concerned about how much testing we have. The latest concern is how much the federal government's involved. There's in a lot of areas, including education. So about a little over a year ago, I said the federal government, we're not going to use the federal assessment standards, PARC. We worked on legislation, got it passed, that said the federal government's not going to data mine our students. On top of that, we said that the curriculum decisions would be made at the local level. Then we moved to Florida standards. And this next year, what I'm going to do is go around and look at all the standards we have, because some of the standards are at the state and some of the standards are at the district, to just make sure everybody knows what the standards are, who's doing them, and do we have the right standards.
Governor Crest.
There's way too much testing in our schools today. There is. And the reason that is that Rick Scott signed a bill his first year in office that I had vetoed. I vetoed that bill because it put too much of an emphasis on teaching to the test. These learning centers have now become testing centers, our schools. And that's not right, and it's not fair to our children. We need to have somebody like me as governor, who served as education commissioner and understands these issues. Under Rick Scott, we have had 4 education commissioners in 4 years. We've got to get our education system back on track. We need somebody who understands it, who actually went to our public schools. I'll do that. I'll make sure it's funded properly. We got to get it right.
So let's look at the results. Step one, our fourth graders are number 2 in the world in reading. Our fourth and eighth graders had the highest student achievement gains in the last 3 years of any large state in the country. Hispanic students have some of the highest graduation rates in the United States. The overall graduation rates for high schools are up about, I think, around 4 or 5% since I got elected. Our African-American students had the highest student achievement gains of any state last year. The National Council for Teacher Quality, 2 surveys in a row, says Florida has the highest quality teachers in the country. Now, when Charlie was governor, 3,000 teachers got laid off. Including Inka Silver, a teacher that got laid off in 2008 because of Charlie's cuts in education. She called his office, and he wouldn't even return a phone call.
Thank you, Governor Scott. I have a question for Governor Crist now. Governor Crist, under your administration and under Governor Scott's administration, scores of children have died under the supervision of the Department of Children and Families. Why are we unable to keep kids safe?
It's tragic. You're talking about the challenges and the difficulties at the Department of Children and Families. And even if one child dies, it's a tragedy, and it's awful. But this is an area where I decided to reach across the aisle. When I got elected governor in 2006, I reached out to Bob Butterworth, a former attorney general. You know, one of the smartest things you can do as a leader is to surround yourself with the best and the brightest. Bob Butterworth was great, and then he was followed by George Sheldon, who's running for attorney general, did a tremendous job behind him. What's important is to be transparent, though. There's a story in the paper today about a lack of transparency on this issue from Rick Scott's administration, and I can't understand that. Maybe he'll talk about it in the rebuttal. But what is important is you have to be clear, you have to be open, or you can't fix the problems to begin with. One of the first questions I got from Bob Butterworth when he was secretary, when we had a challenge with the child very early in the administration, he said, what do you want me to do? I said, call a press conference. Let's shine a light on
it. Thank you, Governor.
We can't fix it unless
Governor
we know
Scott.
About it.
Sure. It's tragic. Right after the Bell shootings, I went and met with the survivors of that family, and your heart goes out to them. We have grandkids. We don't want anything to happen to our children. So here's what we did. When I came in, the first thing we did is we increased the pay for our child protective investigators. Charlie had cut the funding for the child protective investigators. Then we also brought in the Casey Foundation to review what we were doing. They made some recommendations. This last year, I went to legislature and asked for more child protective investigators, and now we have 270 more. And they're going to be able to spend more time per family to hopefully stop this. But here's the positive. It's the number of child death has come down since Charlie was governor. It's not zero. I wish it was zero because every child death is a tragedy.
Governor Scott, thank you. Governor Scott, Governor Crist, now we're going to have a lightning round with some shorter questions. You have 20 seconds to answer the question. I'll ask you, Governor Crist, then I'll ask Governor Scott a different question. And the first question I want to ask you, Governor Crist, is why did you insist on bringing a fan here when your campaign knew this would be a contentious issue?
Why not? You know, is there anything wrong with being comfortable? I don't think there is. Having compassion with other people? We did fine. Thank you, Elliot.
And Governor Scott, why the delay in coming out over a fan?
Well, I waited until we figured out if he was going to show up. He said he wasn't going to come to the debate. So why come out until he's ready?
Governor Scott, why do you keep your assets in a blind trust?
Sure. The reason is so I don't have a conflict. Charlie Crist did a grand jury when he was governor and said that the right thing to do was do what Jeb Bush did and Alex Sink did. Now, Charlie didn't do it. Put your assets in a blind trust so you don't have a conflict. So I don't know what assets they have. The third party runs those assets, and that's what I've done.
Governor Crist, say something nice about Governor Scott.
I'm happy to. I want to commend him on how he has handled the Ebola situation. I want to commend him. It's better to be prepared than panic, really.
You had an extra 7 seconds. Governor Scott, say something nice about Governor Crist.
That was pretty nice of him.
Okay. On that note, the lightning round is over. We were short on time. We started late, gentlemen. That concludes the question and answer portion of this debate. The candidates will now have 20 seconds for, we'll have 1 minute for closing arguments. And Governor Crist will go first, and that was determined by a coin toss. 1 minute for your closing statement, Governor.
Thank you very much. I just want to thank people watching at home tonight. You've seen the differences between Rick Scott and myself. I care about education. I grew up in this state, and I love Florida. I want to do everything I can to make sure that the middle class has an opportunity to do better than you're doing under Governor Scott. I want to make sure that we invest in Florida businesses first, that they have a chance to employ more people instead of bringing big corporations from outside our state. And I want to make sure that we protect our beautiful environment. I love the water, and I love being out on the water in Tampa Bay and my home. And I want to make sure for future generations they have the opportunity to enjoy the beauty of this great state. I'm asking for your vote. I would appreciate it, whether you vote by mail, you vote early, or you vote on November 4th. God bless you, and God bless our Florida.
Governor Scott.
I want to thank thanking my wife for standing by me through thick and thin. My mom's watching from heaven. I want to thank her for being willing to divorce an abusive husband. I want to thank my daughters and for being such great members of our family. 4 years ago, my mom was embarrassingly calling me a good boy, and I ran on campaign to get our state back to work. 700,000 jobs over 7 years. We're on a roll. It's an honor being your governor. It's a great honor. I would love to get your vote. I'll tell you, I'll do everything I can to make sure this is the state that you can live your version of the American dream. Es un honor ser su gobernador. Le pido su voto para seguir trabajando para hacer de la Florida el mejor lugar para vivir el sueño americano. Sigamos trabajando. Muchas gracias. Great to be here.
Governor. Governor Scott, thank you very much. Governor Chris, thank you very much.